Good morning. My name is Jack Dearborn. I'm chairman of the CIP committee for the town of Weare. And at this time, I'd like to ask the members to introduce themselves.
Tom Clow.
Stu Richmond.
Sherry Burdick.
Steve Roberts.
Thank you. And we have some members of the, one member of the finance committee with us today. And today, we're going to hear from the highway department and also Benji, why don't you take it off, or whatever order you wish to have it.
I guess we'll start with the road reconstruction.
Very good.
This is money that we ask for every year to approve the roads in town. I kept the price the same as last year. I've asked for $480. We get a New Hampshire block grant, which will be guesstimated at around $274,458.
So basically, we'll raise the balance by taxes, so that we don't really raise $480.
No, we will be asking approximately $205,542.
Okay.
And I say approximately because we don't know exactly what we're going to get the last two payments, the road reconstruction, but we know roughly. Next year's road reconstruction plan is to concentrate on Mountain Road area and do at least 2 miles of it. And if it isn't too bad sub-material, we'll even further in that area. That's where we do some shimming and some other things in other areas of town. That'll be our main road job for next year. Starting the first pond going up the hill. Really know what else you would like me to elaborate on that. I guess we kept it under
I guess what I'd like to have is a bit of an open discussion. You and I had a little bit of this discussion, is that with all the roads we have, hundreds of miles of roads, some are dirt, which require grading and various other things during the year. And we have asphalt roads, a combination of legacy roads, maybe 100 years old, that have been continually refreshed with asphalt. And probably the base is somewhat dubious. You know, you really don't know what's down there. It could be stumps or whatever. Then we have roads that have been built in subdivisions. I would say probably 40 years ago, which may not have what we consider to be adequate base under them now. Then we have the most recent subdivisions, which are probably up to a specification by validation of an engineer. By kind of doing this, I mean, $480,000 is a lot of money for most people. But if you think about the roads are continually decaying, at least the asphalt piece, and it may be beneficial to consider in future years that we need to at least, for those roads that are worthy of it, at least put a shim and overlay on it to preserve them to where they are for another 15 years or so. Unfortunately, we may not be able to get there until another 15 years, which means they degrade even more. So this is certainly a traditional amount of money that we use, but it doesn't really serve the long-term needs of the town of preserving the roads we have and not allowing it to deteriorate until we get to them.
I took a seminar a couple years ago, and they talked about keeping good roads good.
Right.
And certain towns have done studies, and if you've done an interest overlay every 10 years, or you chip coated or sand coated, what they got in the life of their road, and they claim they're going out 40 plus years their road by doing something every 5 to 10 years on it. I don't think anyone could argue that's, a good program. I think probably every town in the state's in the same boat about not having the money. It's hard to convince someone to go put an inch of overlay on a road we did 10 years ago, and that road hasn't seen anything for 20 years, unfortunately. So if we could come up with something in the future, that'd be great. I would love to go back and do some things on roads that we've done to keep them good.
I guess you could either consider bumping this number up. But a certain piece of this is what keeps your crew busy and pays for material and asphalt.
Yeah.
Not the labor. And so the best case would be coming up with a set of activities that didn't require a lot of your labor, such as hiring contractor for asphalt, which basically they show up, you tell them what to do, and they just do it. The question is, even if you put an extra $100,000 on this, it's not really addressing the larger problem. So I don't know if we do this, consider it for this year and do it for next year, is it makes sense to bond a large amount of money over a 10-year period. We can extend the life of roads, because we're not going to be able to get to a significant number of roads at this number, even if we increase this by 100,000.
No.
So it's somewhere in the $500,000 to $1 million to really save these roads so they don't become worse roads in the future and just cost us more money. So maybe next year we can consider that. Any thoughts from people on the board?
Just a question. This amount of money does about 2 miles of rebuilding?
Roughly, yeah.
And then whatever's left for shim and overlay?
Shim and overlay, yeah, all the way.
How much is the shim and overlay piece that we do each year?
I don't know if there's an exact amount. It's kind of...
Well, what piece of this? Is it half or is it a quarter?
Oh, I wouldn't think it'd be over a quarter. Mountain Road is going to be... You know, they're all, you spend most of the money on your road reconstruction, and if you have any left over, there's always the spots that you know, have to coat a patch every other day. Coat patch is now $125 a ton, asphalt $68, put in place. And a coat patch for $125 and then have two guys go and put it out.
For the truck.
For the job. It's not really cost effective, but you got to do it, unfortunately. So these shim over in areas that are just littered with potholes, it buys you 4 or 5 years and not patch the potholes. There's any kind of spots. You have that list that you go to every day or once every week anyhow, and you know.
So it's safe to say that of the 400, 150 or 100 is for shim and overlay?
Around 100 probably. I got planned this year. Our bid was a little over 300 this year, and you want to leave a buffer because you never know what you're going to run into down below, so you don't want to get your bid for asphalt right to the T. We might decide to do the fire cistern when we go by or turn around or something, so try to leave a little bid over here in this corner. Buffer, so.
What if you increase this by 100,000? Would the state do a portion bid, you know, bump that up? What we get from the state?
No, you get a certain amount per mile, is how that works. Oh.
So we really don't raise the 480 by taxes.
No.
We appropriate it and we raise
205.
205.
Yes.
Has the funding from the state changed much in, say, the last 5 to 10 years? Because we know costs have gone up considerably, probably.
I'm not sure.
No. Naomi, it hasn't.
No, not significantly.
Is the gas tax basically?
Because it's based on the miles of road, and we haven't accepted any more miles of road in the last 5 years, really. If it was based on something different, I think it would be a variable, but where it's based on the miles of road, that's all you have.
Maybe we should talk with our representatives to find out about that funding source, where the money goes, if it, you know, has the money that the state taken in increased in the last several years. If it has, you know, are they funneling it somewhere else? And
are you taking an action on that?
What's that?
Oh. Are you taking an action to go talk to our representatives?
Sure.
Okay, good. Thank you.
I'd kind of like to know, because obviously if costs go up and, you know, that's a funding source, we pay taxes, and, you know, there's a lot of talk out there about trucks, you know, destroying the roads, but trucks pay a huge amount of those taxes, and so, you know, we should be getting the money that we need to maintain those roads, and if the state's already collecting money for that purpose, then it should be going for that purpose.
Yeah, unfortunately, the state has so many of their roads that are in bad shape.
Yeah.
I don't mean the highways, the, you know, the double lane highways, but the roads like 114, 77, and they do these crazy repairs that are all grooved along the edge. I don't know what they're using, but it's...
Actually, the price of asphalt's down compared to what it was 5 years ago, isn't it?
Well, I know it's down from what I paid last year. I'm not sure what it was a few years back, but it's down a little.
Benji, but this 100K that we use for shim and overlay, and I know it depends how bad the road is for the shim, but how many miles do you get for 100K?
Well, if you do 1 inch of pavement, you're not going to go much more than a mile, but you got to shim it, so.
Right, which is...
Which, I don't even know how they figure the shim.
They just basically...
They pick a number, really.
Right. So when they come in, do they estimate the shim and the overlay? And they do it, or you just pay by the ton when they apply it?
They estimate it, so you know what they're coming.
So you think the
100K? You get a road that's really bellied out.
Sure,
like it's going to take a lot more. Yeah.
Took a lot.
So you said rough material, like the state puts down on the roads. Is that a shim? Is that what you mean by a shim?
Yeah. Well, I believe they just do the patches, but when they shim and overlay, they fill in the holes and all the imperfections so they get it, so they can put an even 1 inch or whatever you want for the overlay over the top. So they actually do two, they make two passes so they can compact the shim and then go back and compact their overlay. They will do one shot, but you can't really compact any holes very well.
So
I'd rather see an overlay on roads that we've done in the last 10 years. You know, the last 2 miles of River Road on 77, the Quaker, or you know, half a dozen years, Shady Hill, something like that, you know, because they got good base under them.
What about Mount Dearborn? Is that road going to be redone?
It hasn't been. We put 1 inch overlay on it. I've been waiting because they had a huge logging operation.
Right.
They're done now.
Oh, so they're done? Okay.
Whenever they get to town, they're going to put our inch top coat on it.
So this 100K for Sherman Overlay, you're saying we can do 1 mile?
Roughly. Hopefully get a little more net out of it.
Okay, but I'm just trying to put the sanity to this. If we have 100 miles of asphalt, well, let's say we have 75 miles of asphalt road in the town. At this rate, it's going to take us 75 years to touch everyone. By that time, most of these roads will be back to dirt.
Yeah, that's the thought process.
So it's sort of like having a house and only painting one cladboard a year, and hope before you get back again, the cladboard's still on the house.
That's right.
So, and that's why I bring this up. It isn't that I want to spend more money, but it's a question of you spend the money now, and you can protect these for a number of years where you're going to be rebuilding roads, which is a hell of a lot more money than just putting a shim and overlay on.
Talking a lot of money because, you know, nearly $500,000 here to do two roads of rebuilding and one road of overlay.
1 mile.
Of 1 mile.
1 mile. Of the, I'm sorry, what did I say? You know, even if you say, okay, well, let's bond $1 million, $2 million, still you're still not scratching the surface.
But if you bonded a certain amount of money to go over 10 years, it just becomes a cost of doing business in the town.
Every 10 years come up with a new bond and keep going.
It allows you to accelerate the repair to minimize the deterioration.
Yeah, I understand. I agree. I just,
but it's a lot of money.
It's not going to jumpstart it as much as it sounds, because, you know, $1 million will give you another 2 miles of, you know, in addition to this, will give you 4 miles of rebuilding and 2 miles of overlay.
10 miles.
10 miles. Total.
Over 10 years.
Over, yeah.
And you pick up your 1 mile a year, every year in those years.
So you'd get 20 miles done.
20 miles, a third of the time. I mean, these are the hard decisions. You either kind of, I mean, I'm suggesting we do it this year, but we ought to really look at this and see what the... I mean, part of this CIP is looking at the long-term impact for assets of the town, either taking them on or maintaining them. And we've kind of just made I would say this, even though $500,000 is a lot of money, we made a minimum effort towards preserving our asset. Any other questions on this? I mean, I think we understand, most of us understand what the 480 is for.
Don't pave any more roads in town. Leave them gravel.
We're regressing. Okay. Next, which would you like to talk
about? I'd like to talk about the plow truck next.
Okay.
Proposing to ask for a new plow truck with an all-season sanded body, plow wing. Like we have gotten over the last number of years. Purpose is just our fleet's aging, and if we don't keep replacing the older trucks, we're going to be stuck with a whole pile of ones that don't work. We'll have to do something. Many of our trucks are getting up to 15 years old. I know it was always kind of the hope to keep a six-wheeler around 10, 12 years and a 10-wheeler around 15 years. And we have six-wheelers that are going on 16 years and a 10-wheeler that's...
Do you have a schedule of your vehicles?
No.
With the mileage and hours?
Well, not enough to this minute one. My mechanics were busy last week, so...
Okay, well, if they can get one to us, that'll be helpful.
Yes. I got one I think they done last year. It's not really. So I proposed the 10-wheeler over the 6-wheeler because it's really not a heck of a lot more money. It was around 190 for a 6-wheeler, 220 for a 10-wheeler. This 10-wheeler would have a 12-foot body instead of the 14 that we got last time. It's good to have a couple of real big 10-wheelers, but we have one truck we got a number of years back, it's a weight, I think, that had a 12-foot body on it, and it hauls the load beautiful. We haven't had any breakdowns due to overweight. Big 10-wheelers, you're overweight, 6-wheelers, you're overweight. So you almost can't overload a truck, but it is big enough bigger over the 6-wheeler to make a big difference when you're salting, plowing, sanding, even hauling gravel to the grader. It makes a big difference, you know, spritting gravel, and all of a sudden that 10-wheeler shows up. It went half again further. So, and being it's only 2 feet longer than a 6-wheeler, it's not that much harder to turn around. I think it's worth the money to go a little bit more. Now, I'm not saying that I would like to see the entire fleet turn to 10-wheelers, but I think a couple more of these shorter 10-wheelers, along with our two big 10-wheelers, and then, you know, half a dozen 6-wheelers would be a great help. We still got a couple more plow routes. It'd really be nice to put a 10-wheeler on just because of the distance it is down there. That's where you lose most time salting and sanding, is trucking back to the shop to get another load. And when it comes time to salt, it's crucial to get the salt down when you need it. When you're coming back from Google Road because you ran out at B&B Lane, and you got to get back down there, and it's half hour back in bad weather and half hour back down, you lost an hour. It makes a big difference when you're trying to get out there for commute time. So I really think it's worth the money. I guess a little extra money to go with the 10-wheeler or the 6-wheeler. They should last longer in theory if you're not overloading them as much. And like I said, the one that we have, it's roughly the size that I'll be looking for. It's been a really good truck as far as...
Let me ask the other question.
No, the newest one's the big 10-wheeler. And they're all really good trucks, but we've never had an overloaded issue with this. This 08, was that Volvo that used to plow down south?
Naomi, how do we normally buy these? Do we lease these, municipal lease?
We bought them out, right?
Okay.
So, you're the truck man, not me.
Yep.
There are 10 wheelers can come in two different wheelbases.
You can get them whatever you want. You specify what you want and tell them. So what I'd do is I would call a body company and tell them what I wanted for a body, tell them I wanted a 12-foot body, and they would tell me what I needed, clear back a cab is what they call it. So how much from the back of the cab to the back of the frame is what they need for space, and then that's what you order for your wheelbase.
So when you get...
Clear back a cab.
Is that body the... hold about the same regardless of what your wheelbase is, or do you get a bigger body on it too?
I'd get a 12-foot body. The 6-wheeler's supposed to be tens or closer to nine. The truck we just got, the new Kenworth, that has a 14-foot body on it.
That's what you refer to.
The Mack has a 13-foot. The Volvo has a 12.
So those are the long ones, the 13, 14.
Yep. It's definitely good to have a couple of those. I don't think we need another one right now. Definitely, when those ones come time to replace them, it'd be nice to replace them with people's trucks. I'd like to upgrade a 6-wheeler to a 10-wheeler this time.
I'm glad to see you're seeing the light. I tried to prod the prior DPW director to do the same thing, but...
The biggest cost over this, with this truck over the last one we got, is I'm going to propose an automatic transmission.
Oh, you got an extra set of drive axles too?
Yes, but like over the Kenworth, just for instance, the last Kenworth, this one's almost 10 grand more, but that automatic transmission is very expensive, but I think they're worth their weight in gold. A lot less fatigue plowing and just easier to drive. You don't have to have quite the experience in shifting and stuff. So that's kind of why that's the number looks that high, because the automatic really sends that up there.
So is it the last one a standard?
Yes, it was an 8LL. Very good transmission. It's an Eaton Fuller 8LL. It was supposed to be my truck. That's not why I got the standard. But we got plenty of very good truck drivers, so it's not hard to find someone to drive that. The next one. And it's the heaviest duty.
If we undercoat with the 10 wheels now, if we undercoat, could you ever replace the 12 or 14 damper?
Say that again now.
If the body, because it sees a lot of salt.
Yeah.
If the body was to rust out, then we plan on doing this fully film to undercoat.
Yeah.
The frame should last.
Sure.
If the body goes, could you take and put a 14-foot body on the 10-wheeler?
Not this one.
They
have to get another 12.
Don't you buy stainless steel bodies?
This one that I would... Yes, we have. This one would be... That I would like to propose would be what they call an all-hardox body. Now, the stainless bodies that we've gotten have hardox floors. Hardox is very strong steel. They are 450. It's all virgin steel. It has no recycled steel in it. And it's primed from the minute it cools enough. So, but the sides of the stainless bodies, obviously stainless, the whole box, just the floor is hardox. This one, the entire body, floor, front, both sides are stainless, but the corner posts where your taillights are, where they always rot out, is 201 stainless. It looks stainless, it's painted, but it's stainless. So, I got one of these last year. Last time I was in, and I talked to the salesman, and since they've come out with this body, this particular body company, Tenco, which hopefully we could go for, I'd be about 63% of the sales have been this hardox body. It's a little cheaper than the stainless, and they think it holds up better.
Well, stainless is kind of soft.
It is. You got to be careful about dumping rocks in it. We need it for construction in the summer, riprap and whatnot. And they're fine. Well, we haven't beaten any up because we're careful loading them. But there's two spots I've always noticed rusted on the steel bodies: the ribs and the corner posts of the taillights. A hardox body doesn't have any ribs. It's a smooth side body, and the corner posts are stainless steel. And then you've got the durability of hardox.
How long has they been out?
I don't know exactly. I heard about them 3 years ago. I actually saw them. They had two up. They let Henniker borrow when their garage burned down. And I went and looked at them because I was looking for one. I had a certain number. I had to stay with them. And I couldn't afford the stainless, but once I got to learning more about them, I knew it was back to me.
So it's less expensive than an all stainless body?
They're less expensive by a few thousand than an all stainless. But I like it just because of the durability of it.
And this would, because it's a little bit short of wheel base, it'll plow turn easier on our roads.
Yeah, it'd turn around a little bit easier. Wouldn't what I call snow plow in your intersection, you turn the wheels in and you pick the plow up, put weight on them. I actually did plow with our shorter 10-wheeler a couple storms, and it's an automatic, but it was pretty nice to plow with. We always thought a couple more of them would be handy.
Any other questions?
I just have a comment. I have considerable experience with the standard versus automatic in the fire apparatus. We went to those probably 30 years ago, and it was a big, huge issue at the time. But it definitely, and like the fire service, you're, you know, talking on the radio, doing other things, and you guys are running the plow controls and things like that. So it's certainly letting the transmission shift itself.
Yeah.
Is a big factor in safety, you know, having that extra hand to stay on the wheel. They're durable, you know, they really last well.
It's an Allison, so it wouldn't be anything.
Yeah.
And it's a heavy duty.
Yeah.
I don't see the point in trying to cut corners on the transmission rear ends. You got 46,000 pound rears, I think that's heavy enough. 20,000 front end.
The other thing with it going to the 10-wheeler is you've got a much, much more stable platform, because if you think you'll be, what, 60,000 GVW, somewhere around there, and a 6-wheeler is like 36 to 40, so that extra axle adds a huge amount of stability, because you're not at the edge of the weight for it all the time.
So. Braking and all that.
Yeah, yeah.
It makes a huge difference when you're salting. It just, everything about it, I don't really see a downfall to it other than it's another 20 grand, I suppose. But you're getting a lot more truck, a whole other set of rear ends and more frame. And more
but with the automatic transmission, you know, if you had to change drivers on it, you're not getting two, no two drivers drive the same.
That's right.
So you get more wear of the truck by moving people in and out of it. Where the automatic is just going to be the same steady flow.
There's always clutch brake issues or clutch adjustment issues in the standard. Lots of people claim to have more experience than they do, and don't find that out till you send them out in a truck that's supposed to be an overloaded and get up in the middle of these hills in the back roads. You know, it's not like it's not like plowing out on the state roads. You get up on Greenwood or Chase Hill or something, and you decide you need to shift, it's too late. The automatic will just drop in. You miss it. Yeah.
Oops.
Yeah.
So, Ben, have you got a, you're undercoating everything, you're fluid filming everything,
yeah.
Bodies included, right?
Yeah.
No.
Well, we don't do the outside of the stand.
No, but you do the underneath, yeah.
And the newer trucks now, and they've come out this way for a long time, best thing they ever did, they went to a heavy single frame. First thing they ever did was make double and triple frames, because the rust just gets in between and swells and breaks the top flanges. So all of our trucks now, the exception of the old Mac 6-wheeler, single frame, heavy single frame. So.
Even the alloy steel they have today is a lot different from a corrosion perspective than it was even 10 years ago.
And being able to wash them, I'm not trying to advocate for something really tough, but that should make a huge difference. I mean, on a slow day, the fluid cold, and get the salt off soon. And then just give it a quick shot of oil or fluid film. Because there's a couple there have been oiled just with regular old oil. I know my Mac, when I drove that Mac 10 wheeler, I oiled every chance I got. And it's still in decent shape. So it makes a big difference.
What you got next?
Lastly, thought I'd discuss a new backhoe. Ours has been outdated for a while. It hasn't even been safe for the road, really, because it wanders everywhere and the transmission gets hot the last couple of years. If it's really close, I'll send it out, but it has just had it, for lack of better words.
Now, which one is this? What's the brand?
The one we have is a Furmac. It's been a good machine. We've had it a long time, and it's been absolutely, you know, put through the ringer. But right now,
I think 2000,
so you got 16 years. Yeah, I think it is a 2000, yes.
What's the hours on it from last year?
The hours from last year, yeah. It hasn't got 10,000 on it, but it's got done 8,500 last year.
How old is it? What year was it?
It's a 2016. It's a 2000.
2000.
Yeah. That's probably got another 500 hours on it anyway.
So
2,200.
But it's run. We leave it strictly at transfer station now. Our transfer station is set up to send out half containers instead of loose containers, saving trucking costs, and you can, you know, get more in. So it packs a demolition trailer, metal trailer, and trailer. That's all it has been used for the last couple of years. But used to have a culvert cleaning program. Went out every summer or fall and squeeze a couple months in. Send somebody in the backhoe, a couple dump trucks, and clean the inlets and outlets, culverts, and short ditch line, front bucket if you needed to. We haven't been able to do that for a few years, but the backhoe just isn't. It's beyond being able to do that. Still packs the containers fine. That's about it.
We only have one backhoe.
Yeah, we only have one backhoe. We share it with the transfer station. They pretty much have it most of the time now. It's just the reason I asked this year is because like I said, when we did the truck, we really should try to keep updating our truck fleet for the next couple of years. But we got to try to slide that backhoe in with one of the trucks, be it this year, next year.
Now, would you keep the old backhoe for the transfer station?
I tried to get them come down and give me a price, but they didn't get a chance to come down and give me a trade-in. If they were willing to give me a couple dollars for it, I would. If they said it's still worth 10 grand, then I probably should let it go. I got my doubts about it. It's... the shanks roll right off the bucket, and it hasn't had teeth for so long, and all the cylinders leak on that. And that thing's wicked expensive repack cylinders. Like $300 a cylinder for a package. And you gotta do it, so.
Put up with a leak for a long time.
Yeah. So, it served its purpose, that's for sure. Four things had it, as far as the construction market.
Now,
so you don't need any trailers or any packers or anything like that this year?
No.
So there's nothing for the transfer station?
No.
And the question I got is, a perennial request has been that little skid steer.
Mm-hmm.
Is that salvageable for a few more years?
Yeah. It's got a couple leaks that really need to be fixed, and I think it's fine. I talked to my transfer station foreman and asked him, you know, is there something they don't know about it? But he said, no, it's not too bad. I just need some more tinkering. So I thought if we could put it off for a couple more years, because it starts and runs fine every day, and get a backhoe, then maybe in a couple years replace that.
Another question I got on the transfer station is, that was built when the town was probably 4,400 people?
Probably.
And,
built in 91, I think.
Yeah. A long time.
Yeah.
And, is this transfer station configuration and equipment usable in the future?
The problem with our transfer station is the traffic. The problem with the traffic flow is where the transfer station is located. Now, I don't know, short of building a whole entire new facility, how you're really going to change that. So with line striping and trying to open up, you know, different entrances and stuff over the years, well, actually closing an exit, really, you know, we've tried to do the best we could.
Well,
ideally, you come through your recyclables and then throw your trash. That would be ideal. So maybe in the future we can build a whole new road down around the backside of the pit and build a recycling center somewhere else. But unfortunately, we had an okay facility. Our recycling area is fine, but they're crossing.
Yeah, about a...
Now, when that was built, the reason it's crowded is because we were still throwing trash in the ground. And the concern was it would migrate towards where the transfer station is at what time. Then the EPA stopped all that and capped it. So given, you know, the benefit of knowledge that the EPA was going to come in, might have pushed that back a little bit. But that's kind of why that was kind of set up the way it was. But, you know, that's not a near-term fix. I mean, that'd be fairly, even if you kept the trash portion and moved the recycling, that would still be a pretty sizable expense.
Yeah, because it'd be nice eventually to have them guys inside separating all this recycling.
At least have a roof over it.
It does, but you're out there in the elements.
In the cold.
Yeah. You go to any other surrounding towns that are shorter our size, they have twice the part-time help, and they're in an enclosed building. And our guys do quite a little for what we have. One day it'd be nice to change it, but it's just going to be a lot. So I guess we just made do, and it works fine. Where do you dispose of the trash? That would, to me, would be by far the most expensive thing to replace. So to me, you'd leave that there and put everything else somewhere else. But I don't know really where.
What about creating another entrance, maybe around the back, for the guys that are going just to the back side of the hopper, so they're not driving through where people are unloading?
Yeah, sure could look at that and put up signs that says trash only or whatnot. Kind of raise a question, I guess, unless it was a commercial hauler, as to why they don't have any trash. That's why it's nice to have everybody go by the recycling centers, because then they're more apt to go by the trash first. You know what I mean? Get them, that's what I'm afraid of.
Especially when there's a long line.
Yeah.
You raise a very valid question, because the Department of Labor, she's insistent that we should do something for traffic configuration. And
you mean safety?
Yeah. The reason she did that is she went up there on a day that was busy, and what happens is, as soon as you put the car in park, all the little kids pop out and run into the swap shop. And she happened to be up there doing her inspection, and 3 or 4 kids ran out in front of everybody. So now she thinks there should be a traffic or some sort of configuration to make it safe.
Let me ask this question. We get recyclable revenue, don't we?
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any idea how big that is a year, roughly?
Well, this year it's going to be way down. It's up close to 100 in some years.
Okay, well, that basically goes to the general fund to lower taxes, right? Whereas we took last year, when the town, in their wisdom, decided that they would make the ambulance revenues as part of a, I use the capital. Today it's vehicles, maybe equipment. So regarding the cost of new fire and ambulance vehicles, hopefully, and equipment, that could be sustaining by the revenue. So we're actually lowering $100,000 a year on taxes, and we're having to, every year, beg for a trailer, beg for a piece of equipment that benefits the town on the transfer station. So I know it's all money, but it's a question of sometimes it's a little regressive, meaning the ability to get a capital item approved, because we have to raise it by taxes. Whereas if you had the money in a revenue fund, if that's at all possible, you would then have a way of planning out the expenditures. I know it just raises taxes. I'm not suggesting it's just a sleight of hand, but it's a question of accounting. If you have revenue funds and they're put into a equipment, I don't know, just a thought for discussion.
Just, this is more for clarification, if there's anybody watching at this time in the morning.
Maybe one.
So whoever you are out there, we do have a revolving fund now for the transfer station. The revolving fund basically is, if you pay for dropping off a television set, the money goes into the revolving fund, and that is used to pay for getting rid of that television set. So the revolving nature of it. It's supposed to balance out, so there's not really a big accumulation of funds there. Maybe a little, but mostly it just pays for getting rid of the tires and television sets and things like that. So that's already there, and there isn't any approval needed to spend out of that because it's just an ongoing thing. So if we were to look at a fund for what we're talking about, it would be better to go the special revenue, like with the ambulance, because then I think people will be more comfortable with it because the voters would still control what is spent. So it would be money that would go into a fund, and then even though the money's there, we'd have to go to the voters and say, you know, we want to do a reconfiguration, it's going to cost this much. We already have the money because of the special revenue fund. So I think if we were to do that, that would be the direction to go, not getting into the revolving or adding to the revolving, because people would be more trusting if they knew that they had a say in it before it was spent.
Is that revolving fund designed to, you said there's not supposed to be a lot of extra money. When you figure the cost of disposal of an item, are you figuring what it costs us to get rid of it or the cost of us processing that item too? Because when you set your fees for disposal, you know, I mean, you come and drop a television off and we have to pay so much to get rid of it, that's not the cost of that item to the town. Because we have to have facilities for storage, for handling. The skid steer gets used for handling some of those pieces that get dropped off. And
I think the bigger amount is probably in the demolition materials and things, more than televisions and tires and so forth.
An LP tank.
The hauling and everything comes out of that fund too.
Right, but I'm saying is we're talking about need for expanding the facilities. That's also part of the cost of disposal, because you have to have a place to store it, the processing, the handling. That, to me, should be figured in the cost of disposal. If you're pay-as-you-go type of thing, it's not a true pay-as-you-go if the town's subsidizing the facilities by taxes.
But where we are today, my understanding, and I don't know the exact performance, but you drop an LB tank on, it's $5 or whatever. Drop off a television set, because it has a vacuum tube, rare earth, phosphorus is in it, it has to be disposed of. The town of Weare doesn't have that facility, so we pay up front. If you bring in a load of shingles, it goes in the other way, which is more of the bulk removal. So there's different classes of that. But I think what Tom's saying is the intent for the pricing structure of that is the net zero. They're not trying to make a profit or a loss in the town.
I understand that.
Now, I'm talking about this other thing. This is where people pay us to take our recyclables away. And that is a revenue stream. Mm-hmm. And you can have them separate, or you can choose to do them together. I don't think it matters, but we're talking about, well, at least the discussion is, considering a revenue stream from the recyclables, whether you handle that as two different things or combine them, that's an implementation issue. The real question is, right now, any revenue is coming out of Benji's recycling goes into the general fund to reduce taxes. Sort of the way as the ambulance went to.
Mm-hmm. No, I understand how it all works. I'm simply saying, you said the money is just the cost. Well, I submit to you that if you have a business and you're in that business, it's not whether you're making a profit or not.
Oh, I understand.
Everything costs money, so.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is the fees they charge are intending to cover the cost. The guy come in and take it away, he wants to be paid to take the TV away.
Right.
Bulk storage, somebody's going to drag that thing up to Lebanon, you know, and it's costly.
No, I understand. What I'm saying is that, you know, you have some things that we do through taxes that it's a collective,
sure.
We all pay and
sure.
You use it as you need it. Some things are a fee for use, and if this is sort of a fee for use.
Which one?
The disposal of different
sure.
items, TVs, refrigerators, demolition, then, you know, I'm saying is that I'm not trying to sleight of hand or anything, it costs what it costs.
Sure.
All I'm saying is that if we want to do a fee for the disposal, then the true cost of disposal of that item also includes storage facilities, handling equipment, containers, whatever we need, so. Something that we can look at.
Yeah, and it might be just, the state's pretty strict as far as what they allow revolving funds for, so I don't know if that ever could be combined into one revolving fund or not. We'd have to look into that. You're thinking not?
No, the one side of the transfer station, refrigerators and all that can be revolving, because the hauling expense comes out of that, just a wash. The other side of the transfer station where we just receive revenue, we have to pay special revenue.
But if you had that set up, then you could use that special revenue fund. You could put that money aside, and every 2 years down the road from when you start it, you need a new truck, the money's already there. Or a trailer, or whatever piece of equipment you need. And it's probably a lot easier for the taxpayers to swallow it if they're not coming up with more money.
The problem that comes up with that revolving fund, if you try to increase the cost of anything, I mean, a single TV is easy to figure out, but when you've got, there's a lot of judgment calls being made on how many shingles the guy's dropping off, how much drywall someone dropping off.
But we tried to scale last year.
I know, and that's the first thing that would have to happen, was the scale would have to be implemented.
Yeah. Well, it's kind of following along with what Steve's suggesting, is that if the reason for the scale is all related to material that goes through that revolving fund, then why shouldn't the scale be paid for out of that revenue?
Right.
Because it's strictly used for that. You're not weighing in the aluminum cans or the trash or the, you're weighing in the material that you have to pay to get rid of.
Yeah.
So that's an area, I don't know how you would look at that, but.
You gotta raise your fees, because right now you got a guy getting paid to make a guess on the weight.
Right.
And right now, that's sort of like goes with a daily job. If you want to scale, you're going to have to amortize the cost of that scale over so many years of use, and your fees are going to go up to cover it. So, I mean, there's no magic here. The question is, you can still have your revolving fund, and maybe we're not appropriately putting the price on that correctly, but this whole other item of the revolving fund, if it's possible, of the special revenue fund, just the concept of, does it make sense for it to go into lowering taxes as a general fund, or to put the revenue where the costs are incurred?
Could that you find out if a scale could come out of the revolving fund?
What's that?
I asked if they could find out if a scale could come out of the revolving fund.
But it also be the infrastructure, too.
Yeah, there's not money in there for it.
No, I understand that. I'm just saying legally. If we decided to do it that way, we could have to increase the fees to cover, to get built up to buy a scale.
I'll tell you that the issue of those fees is a very sensitive issue.
I know. And a scale would deal with that even the field, though. I think
you can't make a profit.
Yeah.
I mean to the
people pay.
The people out there paying.
Right.
You know, you raise the fees on that. We get a lot of feedback because it's one thing to think, well, okay, if the contractor's redoing a roof, he's going to bring them down, he's going to fold it into his costs. But if the person's doing the roof themselves and they show up with a load of shingles and it costs them a lot of money, then it's,
Why is it costing me money?
You're right. What are you guys doing?
Tom, why is it costing me money?
I'm paying taxes already on this.
Right.
And then you're charging these. It is a sensitive issue. And so I think we have to be really fair in how we approach it. But it does make sense, what you're saying.
I'm not trying to solve the problem here. I'm trying to at least bring it up for conversation, and then it may be up to the selectmen. Obviously up to the selectmen to decide how they run the town, but this is the forum to talk about these, I call them tangential issues. You know, whereas we had this conversation with the fire department last year. This may also be one that bears fruit, but maybe not.
See, if we were looking at a scale, and it has been talked about a lot, I think that what we would want to look at is, even if it weren't immediately put into effect, a long-term plan. We're talking about reconfiguring down there, and part of that piece is where do you want the scale. So even if it was going to be 10 years from now, we want the transfer station to look like this. We would want that mapped out before we place a scale there, because you got another component to the traffic.
Right.
You have anything else, Benji?
No, that's it.
So if you could get us a schedule of all your equipment and the hours on it. And what else? I think that's it. I don't know if there's enough time this year to at least socialize with the selectmen and the planning board. Not even a request for this year, but at least a concept to lay it down of what a road reconstruction, I call it a multi-year road reconstruction, or whatever you want to call it, as a concept. I mean, we wouldn't be asking this as a warrant item, but since we're supposed to be planning many years out, having that, at least socializing that with the finance committee and the planning board and the selectmen, to plant that seed. I mean, we don't know exactly what it looks like, but either we're going to continue with a 480 and get what you get for the roads, or we're going to make an attempt to neutralize some of the decay. Because the problem with asphalt is, you look at any World War II Air Force base, they were all over the country, hundreds of training bases. What you see now is a field, because asphalt by its very nature dries out. Mm-hmm. And as soon as it dries out and decays, and you know, sort of dilapidates, you're back to sand and aggregate. And once you get the crack, things start growing.
They refine, I was told, by an asphalt company. The oil they use in asphalt is the bottom of the barrel after they can't get anything else out of it. And nowadays, because all the vehicles and things burn fuel, they refine it so much that
the bottom of the barrel is pretty bottom, huh?
Yeah, pretty bottom. There's not much oil in it. That's why it's not flexible. They grow 2 years later, the road spikes, because there's not much oil in it. They do use a certain amount of recycled asphalt. They're only supposed to use a certain percentage. I was told by an actual asphalt company that's why, because it's the oil, crude oil is refined so much. There's no petroleum. I've been pricing out, you know, chip coating, things like that, due to newer roads.
Explain what that is.
Chip coating's when they basically just spray a road surface with oil and put
sand on it.
Sand's cheaper than the chip. And
going back to the 60s.
Well, I think anywhere other than New Hampshire does chip coating on new roads nowadays. And where I grew up, they always have, they still do.
To build a road or just to coat it, or just to put a coat on top?
They coat it over after, but they do it when the road's new. They don't wait. You see a lot of municipalities try to save a road after it's been on the inside. Whether it be a crack seal or a chip coat or whatever. I believe the original one is new. It gives you another wearing course. Town of Antrim's trying. It's expensive. I want to see what it looked like after a few years, because the difference with New England versus the western part of the country is the rocks. Our rock out here is more angry. But out there, it's flat. I wanted to see how it looked after the cloud a couple of years. And it's been holding up in the interest. It just gives it a wearing course. Around $40,000 a mile.
That's chip coat. 1.5 times cheaper.
So they claim it lasts 5 to 8 years. Keeping the road good another 5 to 8 years is what all state.
Can you go over the existing, or you take that off and then start from a rock base?
What if you were to do it again, you're saying?
No, to do it.
So if you pay it, so if you pave a road, say we did Mount William Pond, not that it should go down, we just did Mount William Pond. If you could go back either this fall or next spring and do it while that road's good, that gives another wearing course on that road.
So instead of putting a top coat on, put the
no,
the
do everything
coat
you normally
on.
Would do. Just that's an additional cost. But you could go, say, Hodge and Thorndike, for instance. Them roads got to be getting 6, 7, 8 years old. They're still really good. There's the exception of a couple inside corners have been cracked. There's not a lot of decay there. So if you could go and chip coat a road like that, you would extend the life of it, because it would keep it from cracking.
Would it be worth it to pick a road like
Hodge and Thorndike
or Hodge and one or the other to do that mile to use it as your It's gonna improve it one way or the other, but you just don't know how it's gonna hold up with the plowing and so forth. But do it as an experiment, knowing you're gonna add to the life of it, but it will also give you a view of how it's gonna hold up over time with the plowing.
I would love to. Like I said, I grew up seeing the roads done that way, you know, where I grew up, and I travel back and forth every year, and I stay on the road, I watch all the equipment in every state, how they do their work, and almost every state do it for state work now. I don't know about this town. They're chip coating, either it's an asphalt or they're even doing it on cement interstates now because it quiets down and the tires help. So that
the surface is a little coarser though than a...
Not quite as smooth.
Finished road, right? I mean, because you got the chips on it.
A little. It's not terrible. If anybody ever goes up 202 through Antrim, the airport road, it's just a loop. Must have been 202.
Right. Right.
You get a chance, just get off and go that way. Antrim chip coated that last year. And that road, I was told, was already 10 years old.
Well, you roll it in too, right, still?
Yeah. They,
so that kind of flattens and smooths
it out.
They have
their own machine. I got right out and got right down and inspected it, because that was my biggest concern, was the angular rock out. We don't have the flat type of rock. But I don't know. I guess they got sold on that.
We'll go down at the old East Weare Villers. There's still roads with the lines painted still down there, and I'm sure they did that. You know, the sand, they probably used sand, but the coating of the sand.
They mixed the road right out here.
Was it?
When I was in high
down
school.
Down at the old East Weare Village, where they discontinued the road.
They
still
tore that road
down
up, and they brought the grader in and laid out new gravel, brought in the asphalt truck and poured it on there and Malcolm mixed it on the road.
Yeah, all roads that way. Might be rough, but there's never a pothole.
It's all the same. Now, some of the roads in the town, I'm being very journalistic, subdivisions don't get the wear of a Colby Road or a River Road, and even a crossroad like Ghoul Road get a lot of traffic.
Right.
So there's different uses of roads, traffic count, whatever you want. So it comes into the priority of which roads does the town aware want to focus on. The question is answering why bother doing this. Well, the reason is we want to preserve the roads. And the ones that are wore the most or have the biggest loads on it and the traffic count, that would probably be a candidate.
Yeah.
But then again, there could be some subdivision roads just begging for an inch on it to preserve it and possibly just chip coat.
Springtime is terrible on the subdivision. I always made the joke, I think they must have had a special on green clay in the 80s, because every one of them seems to be the base on it. Somebody always falls through, whether it's one of us, you can't stop oil deliveries or trash pickup, and, you know, there's one particular trash company that has a monstrous 10-wheel trash truck. Can't stop them. So, you always lose a spot of a subdivision every year. So even though they don't get the traffic, it doesn't mean they don't, you know, have the need for it. Another road, and I don't know if this is really the time bringing up, but since talking about the roads, sometime, and I believe Tim brought it up last year, you got to consider what we're going to do with River Road, okay? I believe it gets the most traffic, certainly has a number of subdivisions, certainly gets the most truck traffic.
It's a parallel to 114.
It's, we all know how busy it is.
Well, the amount of money that was loosely requested last year was $750,000, and that was
for a small part of it.
That wasn't the entire road.
I finally found a breakdown of what that was, because I thought that sounded small. And a lot of it was shims and overlays. Now you go up over the hill and down the other side. That needs to be ground up. It's washboarded because of the gravel underneath from traffic, heavy traffic holding back going down that hill. It needs to be ground and regraded. And I believe that the Army Corps built much of that road. And I think a lot of the gravel come out of the gravel pit, I was told, years ago.
Round gravel?
I don't know. I'm not sure. But I think it's good gravel under there, or decent gravel. I almost think we could do something like they did on 140, the state did on 149 District 4 last year. They ground the road, reclaimed it, and they backed up and they spread 1.5 inch stone over the top of it, just to give it some angular rock, and they mixed it with reclaim. And they graded it and they paved it. I don't think we'd have to do a soup to nuts overhaul on the whole road, because there's all cement pipe, put in by Army Corps of pipe lasers. You look in a one end of it, it's a whole moon on the other end. I mean, it was built well. It just needs to be resurfaced, and I don't think, so this $200,000 a mile that I bring up, say we'll go do Mountain Road or do Mountain Pond, we wouldn't have to put that much effort into it, because culverts and gravel's fine. But I think we need to put more effort than simply putting one of the children. And the other problem with River Road is, as far as expenditure, is usually we do 20, 22 feet of pavement 3 inches thick. It would be a waste of time and money if we didn't go at least 24 feet wide and 4 inches of pavement, because of the weight of the traffic and, you know, its higher speed.
Parts of River Road was done under the, like for instance, Peasley Hill going north. I mean, just go past that, yes, all the way to the top and down by Wenzel's. Was pretty much done by the Army Corps of Engineers. There was no road there. In 57, there was no road. 58, there was a road.
I see.
And that's my recollection.
Yeah.
And that would probably have the adequate, whatever the specification at the time, Watkins did it, I believe. They put it into federal specifications. Both ends of that road, back to 77 and Oil Mill, is the old road.
Yeah.
And so I'm not exactly sure what the 750 involved, but Tim was very, very cautious to say that this does not do the entire road. Sections of the road require different stuff.
I would agree with that. From Peasley Hill to Colby Road appears to be where I think you could reclaim maybe twice and then pave, grade it and pave it. Colby Road South, I think, would be reconstruction. It's right down to the old goat trail, and
exactly,
you need to build it up and have ditch lines and everything. And from Peasley Hill out to 77, we did, I think it was the first year I worked here. And I think that would be a good candidate for just a shim and an overlay, because that has that has all melted and gravel under it, and I know that has a good base and new culverts. And so I think, you know, that would be a section we need to put an inch of overlay on, because it's been done last and not let it go.
Are you recommending coming forwards with that this year?
I didn't figure we'd probably make it this year. I haven't got my paving outfit in town. He's supposed to come. We're supposed to go take a ride and give me some prices, but he hasn't come up yet. So. But I did look, and part of his pricing last year was a lot of shims and overlays, and so I think would be more money.
Sure. And by the way, let's talk about your bridge, your favorite pastime. My understanding, talking with Naomi, is that there is going to be a near-term fix proposed and implemented to bring the bridge back to some level of weight.
Most of the lift restrictions.
And then hopefully that's a 3 to 5 year?
Yeah.
5 years.
5 years, he said.
How many?
Minimum of 5.
Okay. So the question becomes, let's say 5 years we get it, and you're probably going to absorb the cost of the fix this year in the selectmen's budget.
Just to clarify, that 5 years, if they get in a queue for DOT for the 80%.
Well, we ain't there yet. Let's talk about how we're going to pay for the 5 years.
Right. I think a combination of there is some money in a bridge maintenance fund, but not enough. It's like 20,000. But Benji mentioned that because of the very mild winter, there's money in his salt line that could be applied to that. So we're talking somewhere between $40,000 and $50,000 to do a repair that could last 5 years. And if you look at the state funding, and this is where it gets a little gray, because there was the possibility out there of us being plugged in immediately to the 80-20 split with the state because of other towns that weren't able to get their bond issues passed, so there's money available. So I'm a little off track here, but I'm going someplace with it. You know, the gray area is, should we maybe just look at trying to get that funding going to do the big fix right away, Or should we do the five-year repair, which would probably get us through to the 2023, when we could get back on the 80-20 anyways. And then we could go ahead with Lowell Road perhaps now. So that's what's out there. But anyways, to go back to your original question, yes, we would find the money in the present budget without going to the voters for any extra money to do that five-year fix.
Okay, to that end, it looks like the CIP is not going to be focused on how to do that in the near future. What I would like to at least have a discussion, quick discussion, is there is a, I would call it dated, there was a letter from Kleinfelder to Tim, dated August 12, 2015. I remember this letter and we discussed it briefly. It basically is the same people that did Peasley, the engineer, his name is Marshall.
The same one working with us now.
He took his Ouija board and figured out, based on what he knew, may not have known exactly how bad the bridge was, based on how he knew, the implementation of a fix of fixing floor beams, taking up the corrugated, putting out concrete down, whatever, it was around the $600,000 fix. Now, 5 years from now, that assumption may not hold because you've got more corrosion. And you actually have more corrosion evident now, even though it might have been there last year. So this number is kind of light, even to rebuild it. If it's say, let's say somebody dropped $600,000 on us, we probably couldn't bring that bridge up to full spec.
Would doubt it.
Okay. Then a question is, to Tom's point, we can play this game of getting on the 80-20 from the state. And in 5 years, will the EPA for the effect on the water and all this stuff, if we could use the abutments of the way they are and the approach on the road and just replace the bridge, you'd probably be around $1 million. If you had to replace all the abutments and the approach from the road to the bridge, it'd be more like a Peasley number of 1.2. But even that is probably light because Peasley Bridge is smaller than this one. So you're talking like 1.5. So the question is, even though we won't have any near-term effect, we ought to park out in 2023 either $1 million, $1.2 million, that hopefully we'll only have to raise 20% by taxes, which means $250,000, $300,000. But I think from a CIP perspective, we know this is going to happen. We don't know when. But I think initially we should make a recommendation to put in a six-year plan. Call it year six. Put a target out there for River Road and whether we get Low Road done and Francistown Road for the Peacock Brook. Consider those somewheres in there so we can at least plan out. And we don't know the exact number. We could argue whether it's $1 million, $1.2 million, $900,000, but it's probably going to be closer to $1 million. So park $1 million out there so there's an expectation of that happening. And that's the purpose of CIP planning, is to go out 6 years, identify those risks in the town. And even though nobody knows exactly what the state of the bridge is, if we did this last year and everything held to its assumptions, it'd be $600,000. I suspect some of these assumptions on how good some of the beams were is not as good as he thought. So I think from a CIP perspective, we can discuss what the proper number is and maybe which year, but I think we ought to make a stab at it. And as we go next year, we become more socialized on what the real number is and when it's going to happen. We can adjust that number. So I think from a CIP, and I guess what we look from you, Benji, is coming up with a sort of a number, and it's sort of a best guess at this point because you really don't know what they're going to find when they do the temporary fix. These are all drawn on assumptions, so I think sometime out in year six, which would be 2022 or 23 or whatever the hell it is, we should park some money, and then that becomes a reality as we get closer, and if we do get into the 820, we only got to raise a certain. what's your thought on the Peasley, excuse me, what's your thought on the Francis, I mean, Mull Road and Francis Town Road, Peacock Park, let's say it. There's two culverts, right?
Nice to do them when they decide to do Lower Road, but we already did Francis Town Road and didn't get to it, so. I really got to do some more research and see where the funding for River Road, what we're gonna end up doing on that. And there's been 100 ideas thrown out there, and they all sound good, but there must be, to be honest, all of them, so.
I've never looked at it. Apparently, it's an 8-foot diameter.
It's a 7x11 squash pipe. The bottom, where the water usually sets, you know, is rusting out. Ideally, if you put a concrete box culvert in, they got these new plastic arches that are pretty cool. The state does a lot of them that has a lot of covers, so they don't want to dig them out. They form up and pour concrete halfway up and leave it there, encase it concrete. There's a lot of different options what to do there.
They were done in 73, according to the state. On page 46 of the New Hampshire DOT Municipal Red Bridge list, you can go online and get that.
Yep.
It's the bottom of page 46 of 50, and it's the two itemized, and they're red in terms of the state. And I did have an opportunity to talk to the bridge inspectors when they're doing the River Road, and they said, look, put your boots on, go and look, it's ugly.
Yeah.
Now, I don't know what
that one. Mean.
Those two.
Because I did go and look at the Lowell Road, and it doesn't look too ugly to me.
Well,
I don't know.
I made that comment, and they said it shouldn't look too ugly.
It's on the Red Bridge.
The Francis Town one completely washed, all the earth washed away. Why the pipe stayed there, I have no idea. There's a little black birch tree about that big around growing on top of the inlet. That culvert never moved an inch. So every inch of dirt left town, and we lost and got it. I didn't see any holes rusted, but it's red listed anyhow, and the state says it is, and I'm sure that it's failing, but
now, is the state funding in place for that already?
For the law.
For the law. Yeah.
For law?
Mm-hmm. What I'm trying to say
quite
is
a little, too, for
that those are risks that are identified by the people who rate bridges in the state.
Right.
And we should have something in some year for an expense on our CIP to at least have an earmark for that, whether it's 2 years from now and it's $100,000. We ought to at least have a line on it when these things put in here, and it could be out in 2020. And we'll, it's whatever you think it costs to replace those two. And if we get the state matching funds for it, it's 20% of your number. So I think, so we use the CIP process as pick what year you think you're going to do it, the total cost, and park it in there with one of these requests. Simply do that. And as well as the major bridge, River Road. And we know it's your educated opinion at this point, but as we get closer, it becomes a firmer number, and we figure out which date we're going to do. That's part of the planning process.
Concerning the state red list, Naomi, did you find out from the state whether or not a temporary fix on that is going to take us off the red list and disqualify us from the funds?
I don't think it's in talking with Tom Marshall. This fix we're going to do is basically to get the weight limit back. It's not going to just because of the nature of the businesses out there, the school, our own truck. Because you load our 10-wheeler with plow and everything, we can't plow across this winter. So basically what we're doing is we're bringing it back to take the posting off, but that's not, the assumption is not going to take us off the red list. This is just going to let it continue, that's why it's just a 5-year limit.
And the second part, my question, on the low road, are we in a time frame there where that funding is available? Because I know sometimes we've had to go and ask for an extension.
As long as you started spending before June 30th of 17, you're considered started. You have to start it in 17 because we have...
So it's this year.
17.
So it's really a this year.
Yeah, it's their fiscal year, July 1st of 16 to June 30th of 17.
Okay, so that's critical as far as this process, whether or not we're going to approach the Lowell Road Bridge project this year or not. Or, and I think we've already done this a couple times, asked them to move it ahead.
But they've been good with us up front the whole time in this deficiency that we had. We now became back on the red list, and I think when we met with Nancy Mayville, she said that we could move it out and put River Road in ahead of it. But that was before we knew what the fix was. We hadn't done anything. That was kind of really a...
Okay, just so I get it straight. We have to take advantage of Lowell and Francistown Road's culvert money, correct, from the state, the 80-20?
Lowell Road.
Okay. I thought it was both.
It was two.
It goes twice.
They're both red listed, but the 80-20 that was through was just for Lowell Road.
Okay, good. Thank you. I missed that. So, should we be having a request for the Lowell Road portion, that portion of the half?
This year?
For this year, you have to raise the whole amount. You have to appropriate the whole amount and raise the 20%. So should we just decide this year to have a request? I mean, you're going to have to figure out what that's going to be, but we need to have a number to plug into this year. Then the other piece, which is the Francistown side of Peacock Brook, that's sometime in the future, right? So we need to have that on the Ouija board, so to speaking. That would be a 2018, 19, or 20. We need to park a number out there. I mean, if you're going to figure out what this would cost, it may be very close to the other one. So I think for this year, we need to have a request for one of these things filled out for the low road side, take advantage of the 80-20. And then we need another one of these for some time in the future when you think you're going to have to need. So just so we get some action items out of here, so I keep it straight. He's going to talk to our reps about getting more money or where it's going. Correct?
Usually
action item number one.
I think what needs to happen is I think we need to have a conversation again with Nancy Mabel, because Benji and I and
did we change from my action item on him?
Well, he can talk on the state rep.
Okay, yeah. Is this relevant to the action item? Okay.
Well, it's relevant to the bridge discussion. To the bridge discussion.
Yeah, but it's really about the road reconstruction money from the state. That's really where this whole thing started from.
Well, that conversation. Yeah.
Well, that's what I'm trying to get. I'm trying to get all these action items lined up. So he's going to talk to some state reps about something.
Right.
We're going to move to something else. The next action item would be on the River Road Bridge, a big fix. We're going to have to park some requests out in the future. So you need to come with a River Road new bridge request in 2021, 22, 23 with some kind of an estimate so we can at least park that in the numbers. Next one is, you need to come forward with a low road, one of these.
I think that's what Naomi was touching on. We need to go back and talk to them.
Before we jump into all the paperwork, I think what needs to happen is Benji and I and Tom Marshall, who's from Kleinfelder, need to have another roundtable with Nancy Mayville, because she threw out a couple options. We can ask that we put Lull out and bring River Road forward.
I understand.
Let me finish. We can temporarily fix it. We can, there was all these schemes thrown out there. But she couldn't tell us what to do because the fix is on us. So we had a general conversation. Now that we have an engineer look at it, the bids are out that are due in on Friday from five or six bridge contractors. Then Monday night he's gonna come in and talk to the board about it to see which one is best. But now that we have our plan in concrete, I think we need to go back to her because she was generalizing everything. And I think we need to, at that point, say, this is what we're going to fix. We're going to move one to here and make sure the plan is still good with her, because she's ultimately the one I have to face.
I'm okay with that.
Okay.
After all that conversation is done,
yep. It
needs to be a low road request. It needs to be a new bridge request for River Road and Francistown Road. No matter where it shows up and what quantity of money, we need three pieces of paper like this. New Bridge, Lull, and Francistown. So, what they are, I'm not discussing, but you're right, those information, that discussion's got to hold. But before we're done with this session, meaning this year, we should have something in for each one of those, unless they go away, which I don't think they will.
And there's one other thing we need.
Excuse me. Francistown Road, what's the traffic like on that? I really have no idea. The Lowell Road doesn't seem like a lot.
Want to go to Francistown?
Everybody.
It's getting more and more, that's for sure. I guess I don't have.
Because you made it next to
it now. No, but, yeah, I didn't mean anything specific. I just meant, is that a fairly heavily traveled or not?
I guess depends what you compare it to. I think it has quite a little traction on it.
If it was not able to be traveled on, the selectmen would hear about it.
Well, certainly not.
Hear about lesser things than that.
Lowell Road doesn't have a ton of traffic, but.
That's because it's.
That's the pothole.
Yeah.
It's so rough, you don't want to drive it.
Well, we got to rough up Francistown Road to
right, yeah,
increase
we
traffic.
Now it's even worse.
I think the one more thing we need, Jack, is a schedule of vehicles and their replacement cycle.
But that's the big plan.
Yeah, he's going to come in for another truck within the next 5 years.
Got to come in what?
For another truck within the next 5 years.
Yeah. We know he's going to wear out a truck.
Right.
Right. It really comes down to what's his salt and plowing roads, right, sanding?
Right, but we kind of like, we need a, you know.
Need a plan.
Right.
But I'm just trying to focus on what we need for this year. And the other thing is, another action, I think, with Benji, I hate to do this to him, but maybe it's not his, but we need to have some discussion about the recycling dollars, so we put it in some kind of a fund. I don't know what it is. I don't know the proper terms. I know it's not a revolving, but I know it's special revenue. And so this just so I get it straight from this meeting, you got one, there's three for the bridges and the culverts, and there's one somehow to at least come up with a thought, maybe myself and Naomi and you talk about it, for the revolving, for the recycling. And that may not happen. It's worth having a conversation.
But at least it'll be on our plan of
which one?
Things we have to address coming up.
Which one?
All three.
Well, I put five things on there. Three of the five will be on it. Francistown, Lull, and River Road.
Right.
Okay? He's going to have a conversation about something to do with revenues from the state. And we also need to do something about the recycling. So there's five things, three will go on the plan. Can we beat this to death?
I have one question.
Sure.
Or one comment, whatever. Years ago, and I don't know if you still do it, there used to be a bridge program where you would go in and clean the bridges and coat them with this stuff to prevent rust. And it was done yearly every spring. Every year they sprayed underneath the bridges and they coated them up, and there wasn't rust issues to speak of.
They're out there washing them today.
But they weren't doing that, right? That stopped for a period of time.
Some of the underneath stuff had. We lost the truck that we had to pump power one up to. And now we borrowed permanently a truck to just do that. And I went down, bought linseed oil, and I need to get some more. Went faster than I thought. We're working on doing all the concrete abutments. That's supposed to
seal a little bit,
I guess. Yeah. There's a new stuff out that's twice as much. They couldn't tell me it was any better, so I went linseed oil. I don't know what it was about. Yeah. And then the wooden bridges have this special copper naphthalate treatment. And actually, when I went to Sturgis this year to buy a T-shirt, I stopped in because the Whitewood South goes next door to Sturgis, and I bought two pails and hold it home with me. So we treated the wooden bridges this year. They should be done every two or three. Just the sun exposure parts, not underneath, just right. Like the guardrail and stuff.
But I can
remember. We're working on it. They got three bridges left, and all of ours will have been washed this year. Very, but I'm like, I'm even gonna do that. I held off on this one a minute ago because I didn't want to
upset anything.
But we'll clean it for whoever.
Oh, you don't want chip, you don't want to. You might bring more stuff off.
Might take out a whole bean.
Yeah, right. So, problem is trying to find water enough now to wash jeepers is at law. Can't believe the drought.
And the other question was, wasn't the lower bridge down by Bovis Trailer Park, wasn't that put in about the same time as Peasley? Weren't those two bridges put in about the same time?
No, well.
It and Clough Park.
That one down by Bovis was done in 58.
Yeah, wasn't it done when they
But Peasley's was done in the 39 when they had the flood wiped out, put a concrete bridge in. And in 89, 88, they put the existing bridge.
Okay.
So, and also the Peasley Bridge going across where Jerry lives out there.
Jerry Little.
No, Jerry.
Oh, Shinner.
That was done in the 30, because the flood wiped everything out. So all bridges in town were basically replaced in 38, 39. Or 39.
40.
So that bridge, that gets some heavy traffic, and it's only an E2 bridge.
So there was the one out by T-Bone's Club Park. I think they were built down by Boulders and all the same time, but they are, those are Army Corps bridges, and I don't really know when it comes time to be redlisted.
Well, you know, they paid for them initially. I don't know who replaced them. But those are all done in 59. 58, 59, Watkins put that in.
Yeah.
But we don't really know the status. And that bridge is actually a lighter bridge than what the River Road is. River Road has no restrictions. Right. E2 means 80,000 on an 18-wheeler. 55,000 on a 10-wheeler. And 35,000 on a 6-wheeler, right? Thereabouts. So when you drive up to a bridge and there's no rating on it, you can run it over whatever the state allows you over weight. You drive up an E2, depends on the number of axles you have.
No more than 80,000.
No more than 80,000
axles you have. And,
even though
the biggest problem is if you do things legally in your permit, and as far as moving way oversized things, the state gives you a map of how to go.
Sure.
The problem right at the moment is there's no way in the River Road that is 9.5 miles long with many side roads off it. There's no way that road with anything over 80,000 pounds.
Be quite a ride down
that,
Peasley
that's
Hill.
That's a huge side of town to have zero access to anything over 80,000 pounds. Mm-hmm. And that's, you know, that's just a large excavator.
Well, Benji, this has been quite informative, and thank you for allowing us to exercise you through this process.
Sure.
Before you go off, next week, we've canceled for next week. Those of you that didn't.
Now, we have nobody else the first
I
time.
I would say we don't have anybody else, which is going to bring me to the next question. Do you want to see anybody back on the 21st? You told Park and Rec.
I think, is that enough time for you to come up with these three estimates?
I'll try.
I mean, we can do them now.
You can work on it with me, you know.
Well,
I'll throw a number out there, but get a professional number, that might take.
Why don't we give him a little more time? We can get police back here before he has to come back, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, what we try to do is, next week is going to be a skip, so then the county, the 21st is second round. It's supposed to be finalized.
Right.
But everybody should come back to second rounds on the 21st.
Yes.
Park and Rec's coming back. You want the PD back?
Well, Parks and Recs have a bigger issue. There are some things we asked for, like the deeds and the agreement, if they can get their hands on that for the tents. But as far as the boat launch and as far as the reconstruction, I don't know how they're going to come up with a number without having an engineer at least taking a snapshot and giving a, you know, which way is it? Is it 150,000 or is it a... I mean, the only way you can do the boat launch is by asking some other town or the fish and game who's done one the last 5 years and take a look to see if it's relevant to the size and scope of ours, because I don't know how to do it any other way. So we can see what they're coming back with, but I don't know the fidelity of the numbers that's going to come up. They may have a plan. I don't know. I think the reconstruction's probably the top.
Okay, so you want Sean Kelly to come back?
I think Sean Kelly needs to come back, the chief.
The cars?
Cars.
Hmm.
Hopefully, we can have some conversations on how to pay for it by then. I mean, he's not responsible for that, but I think it requires the board to have a conversation on that. He's asking for leases. So we're going to skip next week, and we're going to do the 28th and...
21st. 21st is final round. Then I think what should happen is the 28th, Beth and I are gone to a health insurance.
Do you want to kick it out to October?
I want to do the first Wednesday in October and be done.
Want Benji to come back then?
No, I want Benji back on the 21st.
Okay. Okay.
Because your last time, you're going to sit and do your whiteboard and make your finalization and then move forward.
I'm good with that if they can handle it. And Benji, I'm happy to help you on this, at least to get a notional number for these future years.
Yeah.
I mean, it only happens if it happens, you know, but at least we don't know what a new bridge is going to be, which side of $1 million.
Right.
So park it at $1 million and assuming that we're going to get 80-20. And if that don't happen, that becomes a different problem. All based on the assumption there's going to be 5-year usability.
October 5th will be the last one. But that, just for the new ones, that meeting usually is like, well, we don't have that many requests this year. We stay here till we're done. Usually we try to get out of here as soon as we can, but we don't have as many requests we put on the board, decide what we're going to push forward, and then that's kind of our finalization. Because Jack, I did commit to the finance committee last night that you'd make a visit there October 11th.
Okay. It's so
I committed you there.
All it means is that you and I get to work the day before that to get this together. So what the whiteboard exercise is, for those who don't know, we basically put all the requests up there, and these two pages here, whatever these two pages are this year, it's basically what we're going forwards with. So this is where, I mean, there are requests that are going to get needed, and there's requests that may be pushed out. But for the most part, we qualify them on a respect of, are these rational? Does the money equal the need? And is this timely? And that's sort of the criteria for the whiteboard. So when we're done with the whiteboard, Naomi and I magically create this thing, which is all the rationale and stuff from the departments and why they need it. And this is basically the document that I pitch.
So you don't need the fire back at all, right? You guys will clear with that?
I think.
Well, I'm just saying, second round.
To be honest with you, maybe I just need to talk to Chief Bob, because he had a 225 number for brand new.
Mm-hmm.
He had 100 for recycled, whatever you call it.
And I believe he said he was okay with recycled.
Well, he said that, but I hope he didn't acquiesce to our questions.
I don't really think
We're okay with that?
I do. From Empire.
Then I need to have one of these from him
revised,
filled out for the $100,000. Okay, so if he doesn't want to come, just submit his piece of paper, and we'll take that as his input.
We have a meeting Monday night, Monday night, so I'm sure we're going to be talking budget issues and some of these things.
The important thing is we want to work with the department heads to find out what they need, you know, and then we're here to help understand that need and promote it up to the various reviews. And we want to make sure he didn't just get tired of the meeting and say, I'm okay with option four.
No, so he came in prepared for that. That's why I needed the board.
Okay.
Can you help me with a question?
Sure.
Going back to Peasley Bridge for just a minute. Not Peasley, but the River Road Bridge. On Monday, will you be asking the selectmen to make a decision on that
Yeah, Tom's coming in, Tom.
On that funding, okay. I wanted to say it now, so everybody would hear.
Because he's putting everything out to bid, he's getting it back, the bid's back on Monday. It's gonna give you the dollar amount and the timeframe, because we talked about timeframe, because he said, what do you want for a timeframe? And I said, sooner the better. And so part of your bid is gonna be, A, how much is it gonna cost, and B, how soon you can do it. Because if you're gonna do throw this out, 40,000, can't do it till November, or you can do 42,000, I can start tomorrow. You know what I mean? I think that's something we have to look at. But that's why I wanted to, I don't want to go back and say, well, when can you get started?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I just think we need to get it done to, he's everybody.
Yeah. I mean,
if you got six different bids, you're probably gonna have six different timeframes, so you'll have...
Yeah, there's some analyzation we could do, but he's gonna do that Friday and bring it to us Monday.
Yeah, I just think it's important we move on it right away so that we can run our safety equipment and plows over that this winter.
Right now, we're gonna be responsible for doing the staging area, but that's not gonna be a problem either because the town took that property for taxes. So Benji and those guys are gonna trip some trees and put some material in there so they can stage their stuff there.
Perfect.
Water's low. We should be able to ready to go. Should be warm enough still.
So, are we done?
I believe we are.
Good. Thank you all.
Yeah, move from here.
Jared.